All right, let's take a look at these tracks. I've been looking online at some photographs, particularly of the ones that are in service right now in Gaza. And there seems to be quite a bit of rust on these things, more than I've portrayed here. So I think that's what we're gonna focus on today, among other things maybe, is I'm going to work on these tracks. And I'm going to make a departure from how I usually do things and how you see other people usually do things. So I'm gonna tape these off to match these wheels. The idea is that where these wheels rub on the track, it's got a metallic look. And the rest of it is gonna be kind of a rusty brown.
So first off, what we're gonna do is lay out some of this masking tape, and I'm gonna cut some strips to the right width and slap that down on the metallic area. And then we're gonna spray it with the rust colors, which are very heavily thinned. Just keep that in mind. And then we'll add some pigments after that. So grab yourself a beverage of some sort, whether it's coffee or whatever, and hopefully this will be of some entertainment value.
So my idea is to use this life color rust paint, and I'm going to actually spray it. Usually I just plop it on with a brush, but this time I want to have that nice inner track, so I'll be using the airbrush. So I'm going to do another hotter one, but I'm going to thin it down really a lot because I don't want it to go on like paint. I want it to sort of maybe sit in the recesses because I don't want to lose all that metallic that I put on. One thing about these life color rust colors, if I buy them again, I'm going to put them in a different jar because they dried out in these ones, and the lid is hard to put on afterwards. I mean, that was my experience, but so yeah, I would transfer it to like an old Tamiya paint jar or something like that instead of keeping these ones, because
I've lost the use of probably about 30% of it because it dried out here. Lots of water.
All right, that looks pretty good. It is my belief, and it is my experience, that every time I build a model, there isn't any formula. There isn't any step one, step two, step three, step four, step five. Every model I ever build, I always am a little confused at first at how I want to go about aging it, you know? So when I'm aging something, it's usually a specific look I'm going for. And sometimes I'll do one thing on one build, but I'll do something completely different on another build. And so anybody that's new or trying to understand how to do all this weathering and stuff, I would just suggest that, you know, there's a few things that you can do, you know, but try not to get stuck in a methodology. Be open-minded as to how maybe you're going to approach a specific project. That's my advice, because for me, every time I do one of these things, I start out scratching my head and then I proceed, and usually one thing follows another, right? Like, I remember watching a video in high school, and it was about Jasper Johns, and he was talking about when you have a blank canvas, like, where do you start a painting? And the thing is like, you have to make a mark. And then you make another mark. And then what starts happening is those marks start pushing back in a way. You know, and it starts giving you a place to push back with another mark. Or another shape or something, right? And I think for me, it's sort of the same thing when I'm doing this weathering. Is like, I'll do one thing and then that'll trigger my mind to think about what can I do to add to that, or counteract it, or amplify it, or, you know. So yeah, my point is, every model I do, I approach differently. And the methodology I use usually is different from the one before. Thank you.
At this point, it is now time to enter the realm of pigments again. And we will be applying these pigments to the hull, first on the side, and then on the front and back. The usual technique of adding the pigments first, and then coming back with the Tamiya thinner to make sure everything just stays in place.
So here I'm just trying to get rid of any of the excess. I don't know how much more pigment I want to put on these wheels, because I don't want it to be like mud. It's just more like encrusted sand. I don't know. I see in some photographs that, you know, there's a bit of a buildup of this stuff. But I don't want it to look like mud. So maybe I'll add a little bit of this lighter pigment as well, but not too much. Like I say, I don't want it to look like mud. Plus, I don't want to lose everything else that's on there already. So I want to get rid of it off the hub. Before I hit it with the Tamiya thinner, binding it.
So I'm using some of the AK engine grime or engine goo or whatever it's called, just to sort of give an impression of some kind of like oil leakage here and there. And I'm taking it straight from the bottle, but then I'm interacting with some paint thinner to kind of make it spread around a bit and have different viscosities here and there. I'm not going crazy with this because most of it probably won't even be seen once the wheels and the side armor is on, but you know, every bit helps to give it another layer of fantasy aging.
So get a little dust on these wheels because they wouldn't be pristine. Get it on the inside. I mean, at a certain point, you have to stop, but it's kind of difficult because when you look at real tanks that have been in the field, they can have many, many layers of dirt and dust and mud and, you know, rain and whatever. So, but yeah, at a certain point in the model building realm, you have to stop. Right? I think I'm going to add some of this dark wash here and there too. Just add another layer.
So let's add some Humbrol gunmetal to where the sprocket teeth come in contact with the tracks. So we'll put this on and then buff it up to some degree.
Thank you.
So I'm using some clips to help hold this together while it dries. And then I'll have to paint that one to match the rest, but it'll get rolled up. I think it's time to add these now before I go to tie everything together. This is all in a good place now, so I can move on. So in a way, my approach to doing this is like how I do anything creative, in that I'll work with the big strokes first, right? And then as things kind of start to focus down, then we can get into a bit more of the detailing of things and whatnot. So we're getting a lot of the big stuff done now. For example, I want to come back and take care of the exhaust soot that you see in photographs. I want to start doing some aging on this stuff, you know? And wherever I've been handling it, with some of the pigments falling off maybe, I can come back and add some. But you got to get to a certain point where all the big strokes are done, and then you can start to focus in on the details, which, yes, can be a little bit more fun. Maybe it's time to start taking some of this masking off these periscopes. So yeah, here's these, let's remove the micro mask that I used for this lens here. You can see it just pops right off, and then any unsightly stuff I can just wipe off with this toothpick. And there's this one at the back too. Nice that it pops right off. Well, they did on the front anyway. There we go. You see? So easy. So there we go. You see that? Here we have these screens that go over the headlights. So this is what you need to add. So how am I going to glue these on? Well, I'm going to use some future. I know there's some out there that think that future is the worst thing ever invented, but actually, it has some good uses, such as an adhesive in certain situations.
So I've added this spare track here. And here is a smaller one that goes on the side here. You have to be very careful with these plastic chains and balls, like when you're dealing with the turret, because when you're going about working on this and you lean it the wrong way, you can end up breaking one. One or two. Well, I'll fix them later. Okay, these.
So, they only give you the brackets for it to be closed up over the explosive device. So, you're kind of stuck with it. I mean, I could probably fool around with it or scratch something of my own, because it's not that complicated, but out of the kit, there's not much you can do.
Okay, guys, that's it for today. I think we'll wrap it up there. We're coming along pretty good. I think what we're going to do next is get on those decals. And after we've got the decals on, then we'll take a look at adding more aging. Not sure what I'm going to do yet. I'll have to be in the moment and see what it takes to get where I want to go. In any case, in the meantime and in between time, that's another edition of Jet Scale Models. Y'all come back now, you hear?